Good afternoon. Today is the 23rd December. This is the realm you are working right now, data and program, that is output. And this is the way the Python is most suited for. So there are a lot of label data is there. You know that this is label data and this is lots of raw data. And this is label data means the data is already identified, whether the credit card is worthy for giving more credit or not, this classification. Whether somebody asks for a credit card, whether you will give yes or no, or spam classification, email spam, email, lot of email like good luck, please free membership, these are the keywords, wish you all the best, good morning, and these are the, say, automatically they detect this is a spam. So this case is the, we can write a small program so that it can output is a program. So here the machine learning output is a program, because what is the reason? Because we have already labeled data. So this is the very interesting area of machine learning. And here one of the good point is traditional logic, like whatever logic you are doing right now, like if then else, why do, and lots of loops and all these things are not much required there. They are basically block driven programming, because everything blocks are there. You have to just incorporate the layers into layers, and you have to fine tune the layers, and in fact hardly for loop is there, no while, no for. So that kind of loop, checking loop is not there. You have to just import, say, import PyTorch, import TensorFlow, import Keras, import model, built model, linear model, serialized model or parallel model. You just give some name. And it, the program will be very, maybe 10 lines to down, maybe 100 lines. But it really work. It by traditional programming, whatever the result we are getting, say 80% accuracy, here we'll get minimum 85% accuracy. Because this is the machine learning. The advantage is that here, because the reason is that lots of data are there, not 120, maybe 1000 to 2000. 100k data is there, and so there we can quickly write a program, and we quickly find an unknown case. Most of the, you see the vaccine right now, the why this vaccine are quickly developed. Earlier it would take the 10 years, 9 years, 8 years. Now we see the vaccine is developed with accuracy maybe 94.5, 90, 95.5, because of this of machine learning, because lot of things can be compressed in time series. One of the reason, not all, because a lot of this analysis portion earlier was done by expert, but right now it would be any layman. If you write a code, that is a job of yours, machine learning specialist, so we can do this. Really, this is our main game point. In machine learning, we are interested here, and one of the good point is that you already expert, I observed the last class, I have taken also some small few lectures on NumPy. Because in NumPy is very essential building block. What is the advantage of NumPy? You all know that it is a contiguous memory location in RAM. The RAM may be on your machine or target machine, generally target machine, generally on your client machine, your server machine, is a contiguous memory location of the same type. Say integer 8 bit or integer 16 bit or 32 bit, that contiguous huge area. You NumPy, that's the advantage. You can remotely compute. And then we can we'll give a concept of GPU. All your laptop and have GPU, definitely NVIDIA, or my case is Aron or something. So NVIDIA, you can run the GPU, and some of the program, graphics program, run 10 times, minimum 10 times to 50 times faster. And nowadays you can lots of CPUs and GPUs are available. One free example is Colab. Colab, you give a 12 GB RAM and another GPU, another TPU, you can run your program for 12 hours, and that's it. So it can be lots of machine learning, not very rigorous virus training, but for a learners, it is good enough. Okay, there are lots of problems are there. So, and what I am saying about the NumPy, what is the great you have done your NumPy, the same almost 99.9 code will be NumPy nomenclature is same as a TensorFlow. Whenever you write import TensorFlow as TF or import Torch as TH, NumPy is converted to tensors. The difference of tensors is nothing like is a scalar and is a vector. Whenever you see a vector, you know the vector is a direction, value and direction, that is a vector, and whenever it is a three dimensional, we call it a tensor. So, if we have a say 5 number, this is scalar and the rank is 0. If we say an array 5, 1 in an array, then we call it a vector because it has some two dimension. If we have a another dimension, say 5, 4, 1, 3, then you call it a matrix, and whenever you go for this matrix is repeated in dimension, this same matrix, then we call a tensor. So, tensor is hugely used, and what is the advantage? Right now, say our image, two dimensional image, you can replace it with a matrix, maybe three dimensional image also a matrix. But whenever you get it a video with time series and your XYZ series, then it can be fitted in a tensor, and lot of video processing, image processing and machine learning things are going on. So, these things can be well suited not in NumPy, this will be suited in tensor, the same as nomenclature is commands are almost same like NumPy, but you have to in Python, that is the advantage, you have to import TensorFlow as TP or TF, sorry, but it can anything, or import PyTorch as TH. These are two computing, other is Keras model is there. Keras is works both in TensorFlow 2 and PyTorch. Google developed TensorFlow 1 first around 2015 and 16, but TensorFlow 1 little hard to start with. TensorFlow 2 is very simpler, is much easier, so no use for TensorFlow 1.0. Most of the Google product now using now TensorFlow 2, whatever you are using, all Google products, Gmail, YouTube, all are using the TensorFlow, and they run their model maybe at your Google client also. So, this is a small model, they can run on your Gmail, whenever you create a Gmail, it can run it there in mobile station, you can small artificial neural network, not only at the server and your desktop, you can run the TensorFlow 2, that is advantage. Another competitor company, Facebook, they have developed this PyTorch. PyTorch and TensorFlow 2, 95% compatible to each other. So, in Colab, one good point is Google Colab, they facilitate the PyTorch also. So, my students in my earlier year students projects, they have done most work in PyTorch, which is very easy to learn and everything is there. So, PyTorch, I'm discussing about this TensorFlow and PyTorch because these can take your image data, audio data, video data and put it in like array like thing, but not in a NumPy. But NumPy is the problem is NumPy is good, but it's good for only floating point data and for limited size. It can only work in a CPU. You cannot work a NumPy in a GPU. You cannot translate to GPU. What is the GPU? It's a graphics processing unit. The typical von Neumann architecture is not there. It's a graphics processing unit. Like NVIDIA is the number one maker in GPU. Intel is also trying TPU, tensor, that is Google is developing one tensor processing unit. Directly they run the tensors on their hardware, which is 50 to 60, 100 times faster. So, that is a correlation I am telling that. Difference between NumPy and Torch and TensorFlow. I used to take one or two questions. That will be interesting. Anyone? Shaurashish or anyone? Ankita? Anyone make a question? What is the? I am setting the context of why you are today discussing this. All these things. Yes. Anyone, please. Are you getting my voice?
Yes.
Picture. The screen are visible.
Yes, sir.
Yes. So, one or two questions, please ask. One or two questions, anything. If it is a, it will be helpful for me to how. Any question, please, Subhrashish? Are you getting the which context I am telling this?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Say, go to the next screen. Hopefully, yes. This is another term we should know, overfitting. What is overfitting? See, we are basically right now in the machine learning stage. In last of my YouTube class, I have shown you fitting of a straight line. You have given a number of points and we add some y equal to mx plus c and we add some arbitrary noise. If we do not add noise, a straight line would fit into that. You can see my earlier video. And if we add noise, a straight line will be automatically drawn and m and c, they will give it back. And that is by linear regression. That is the simplest model. It looks simple, but it's computed, it's easy. But whenever the variable is 2, then straight line. Whenever the 3, then it will be a plane. And whatever more and more variable, then it will be a hyperplane. So all is very easy. It is a regression problem. You know, machine learning, there are two kinds of output. Either output is floating point or real number, then we call regression. And whenever it's a classification, say yes, no, or tumor is bad, very bad, critical, like these are the classification. The two types of problem. So, but always when the output is coming, say here, say this is a good generalization, I am okay, and this is overfitting. What is overfitting? Overfitting means it is too much fits the data. So, that is good. This too much fitting is bad. It is bad machine learning. Because why? As if you are draw point to point itself. So, that is not machine learning. Machine learning should be a curve which should not and may or may not go to the points, but it should be nearer and it should have some smoothness. It is not a zigzag thing like here. It is overfitting. That is, we should avoid how overfitting the data, because we have keep remember we have kept certain data not to be trained. That is called a testing data. We should keep aside the testing data. And we other 9 times we use for training. The training, the data would be like this. But when training the data will be like this, and whenever you see the put the unknown data, then it should be widely varied. So that is bad. That is the reason we always want this kind of fitting, like training, not this kind of fitting. That is too much close fit, and it is not good for unknown data. I think it is understandable by you. Can any of you say yes? And this
yes,
is
sir,
yeah
sir.
Yeah, great.
Yes,
so this is I have covered in my last class. This mainly we are focusing now on supervised learning. Supervised learning means you have already trained data, and this is unsupervised learning. Unsupervised learning means it will automatically learning, like email spam. The email spam detection is basically unsupervised learning. A lot of unsupervised learning are there, like rays are coming to our telescope or in the telescope there in the all over world. They are learning the galaxies and mapping. Nobody is there. The image processing are, they learn that if there is an unknown galaxy, this light is coming or not. These are the highest example of unsupervised learning. This is really tough. And this is another area is reinforcement learning, that is quickly coming. I have covered little bit. Reinforcement learning is you are taking some steps with some intelligence, but you are not getting your result in one or two steps. Maybe after 20 steps you will get the reinforcement learning. Like I example that whenever we human are learn something between 0 to 1.5 years, then we learn by ourselves, by touching or seeing something. In fact, our eye is also not become powerful because after maybe 6 months or like this. So that is a reinforcement, is a self-learning. So these are, even the software can do this thing, and it is already proven unsupervised learning. That I have given example like zip code classification. The algorithm is unsupervised, and supervised learning is the most common. So we'll start from supervised learning. I think next, go to the next slide. This is I have already covered. Yes, this is the same thing, the supervised learning, unsupervised learning and reinforcement learning. Why I am giving different slides, pictures? Because sometimes pictures can speak 1000 words, and sometimes different pictures give different nuances. Yes, this is we are here already given linear regression example. This is the right now the artificial intelligence is the superset, the machine learning is the subset. Artificial intelligence starts from Alan Turing, the crucial paper, not automata paper. He has written one great paper in 1950, the Turing test. What is Turing test? That the three persons are there in a, you know, anybody know the Turing test? Yeah, the Turing intelligence test. Yes, the Turing intelligence test is nothing that two persons are separated by a wall. They do not see each other. Two persons, and they can only type it by a typewriter or something. The noise is also the only one strip, the message will go, and one person asks a question and other person receive that. If the person cannot detect that other person is, by whatever question it is, the other person is a machine or man or woman, anybody, so then it will pass the Turing test. So we are basically like typical nowadays, we have lots of communication chatbot, like chatbot, intelligent chatbots are there. Sometimes maybe 2-3 minutes you cannot understand whether the chatbots is really a machine or man or woman. So Turing intelligence test is that a computer can be intelligent enough that it can mimic the human. So Turing give a test, and that is the start of the artificial intelligence, and then comes the subset of the machine learning, which is coming only the programming part, and this is a deep learning. This is now is very prevalent area because lots of neural network type of machines are available, and NET, and also people, the good costly institute like IITs and IIM, they have some good infrastructure. They have the deep learning framework. IITs have so they basically the artificial neural network basically mimic our, getting inspired from our brain. So they have some layers of small neuron type of CPU sort of thing. It is a hardware, not CPU. It is a small neuron. Like we have certain inputs and one output axon, and the inputs are coming to dendrite, like our neurons in our brain. They mimic it, and they have a separate layers of neuron. So this is the input layer. The images are body areas coming, and there are maybe 10 layers. They are selecting one feature at a time. See, they are taking image, one layer detecting only edges, another layer only detecting say eyes, another layer eyes and ears and all, another layer maybe the how fair or fairer. So these are different layers detecting some features of the scenery, some features the human face, some is the other creature face. So these are the all, and then at the output layer they can really depict the scene. This is the input image, and these are the things are there in the screen. Basically your Facebook Facebook or any camera, they are basically detecting human, and they already, you have already saved it, your image or your friends, they automatically detect it. This is nothing but nowadays deep learning. So they basically use layers of artificial neural network and same programming with Python, they can detect. So you can write a good application on it. Okay, so basically these area we are here. So let's go to this. These areas, this is the rule based decision making, and this is, we are here at the machine learning. This is the statistical reasoning. After getting the data, here the rules are, that is you are using if then else type of, if then else, or you take the various rules, if it is there, if it is there, it is maximum. This is rule based and decision making. That is also good, and this is statistical. You take some statistics of values or mean, median, mode, or other skewness or other things in histogram and all these things, then you take decision. This is statistical modeling. Say it is prevalent in 70s, 80s, 80s, there are lots of CPUs are there, still there it is very popular. Okay, then it's come, we are here right now, machine learning, it is your program is automatically learning itself, and that learning by artificial neural technique, you give the data and it learn itself, and not only learning, it can transfer the learning to another new machine. That's great enough, because you human, you know, Every time the child is born, he or she has to learn by himself or herself. But here, right now, the machines are available. You can transfer your machine learning to this. Like you remember your Facebook. Say you leave Facebook or suspend your Facebook ID. Whenever you join, all the data is stored there for you. You deactivate your Facebook account, and then so machine is stored. But if you delete your account, Facebook is not supposed to keep your data. But I don't know whether they're keeping it or not. Facebook is sometimes very unreliable. So what I'm telling that the data is always there. Then this is a more advanced is artificial intelligence. But machine learning is right now is doing havoc right now. Any question you can. So supervised, you know the data are there. Unsupervised, you know data, but it's finding out. Like I have told you, the spam mail or like this. Yeah. Yes. This is the clustering versus classification. Classification is supervised, and clustering is nothing but unsupervised. It will automatically detect the cluster. No cluster level. It is other way clustering. That is unsupervised version. Anyone, please, any question you can tell me. Yeah. So classification algorithm. Yes. Any question, please. Yeah. Anyone?
No, sir.
Okay, great. So classification, the linear classification. The logistic regression, I have given a simple example. There other is naive-based classification, whether is the probability is there. If A is happening, what is the chance of probability of B? If B is happening, what is the chance of probability of A? Like both, and whether the C, these are probability based, there's other things. So we'll whenever time comes, but I'm telling you this is the thing. Let's do some programming. I think then it will not be a boring thing. Let's see, we can reconnect our screen. The screen is visible. I hope so it is. It is screen is,
yes,
yeah, great. So
yes, sir.
Thank you. Should I make it the font larger? This font?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I am trying. Okay. Okay, this one is okay?
Yes, sir.
Great. So in Google Colab, you should practice Google Colab. Until and unless you are working on a Raspberry Pi, Colab is fine. But your exam time, I repeatedly say, you have to do your own machine. Colab may not be available anyway, but for all other works, Colab is best. So I run this because it will give you the what is the my current sale, what is the time it is taking. Okay, and it is also my GPU is also enabled. My runtime, you can see runtime logs. No, I don't want logs. Sorry, let's hope so. Yeah, I am not interested to see. I see my runtime, I make a GPU runtime. Okay. So this is, I am using the TensorFlow. Yeah, this is, I am using the TensorFlow. The TensorFlow is the same as NumPy. Don't think TensorFlow is a very big thing. It is basically a NumPy, but which can work on a GPU. Okay. Or TPU. This is the great. And what is tensor? Tensor is nothing but extension of your vector. Your scalar quantity is only a say 5 number. Whenever in an array, say 5 comma 1, we call it a vector. Whenever we say 5 comma 5 1 and 4 3, we call it a matrix. Whenever the matrix is repeated in array, we call it a tensor. And it can be higher dimension also. Mostly we are work 4 dimensional, like video and all, image or acceleration, 5th dimensional, very common now. Right now, the lots of machine learning problem is working on 4th dimension and 5th dimension. There, your CPU or any CPU is not good. If the data is basically data are video data or image data, like in image may be from camera or it may be any other medical images like MRI or CT scan and time series. You have to record a data for, like you are recording data from the remote stars for hours and hours and days after days. So this kind of time series data, it will be better worked with a tensor. And Google has given a free software on it, that is a TensorFlow 2.0, and competitor Facebook have also given the totally free open source. That is a great thing. And they are all depending on Python. Another software is there, R is also very good. That is also open source, but we will not export to R because the same thing, Python is right now overtaking almost R in popular application. R is good for visualization only probably. For machine learning, Python is very good. And what I am supposed to talk, this TensorFlow 2 and the other model is PyTorch, which given by Facebook, is pretty good. The most of this right now, the machine learning or deep learning activities in various hackathons and all this thing work on it, and they are all syntaxes with NumPy, and that's it. So here we have just imported TF, and I always check this one. I think it is a good practice if you just check all those versions. Then I go to the another comment that I probably shown it to you. In Google Colab, you want to get the feeling of how hard, whether the Waze is there. That Waze is not a view at the remote location. So, and to run the Waze command, you have to run import Waze and then import Waze get current working directory, and then it automatically print, and I see what are the ls. I can change it ls. I think it is better ls minus l. What are the number of files? So let's run it. You see it here. This Unix is working at the your Colab machine. Okay, this is a Colab machine. So I have already have some sample data directory there. So this is my G drive, my Google Drive with my Gmail on Google Drive. So I think you should get a feel of data. Okay, I think next go to this is. It is a C profile is profile of TensorFlow. This is called eagerly mode. Eagerly mode means basically tensor is like a graph, and when the data is accumulating at a node level, the graph will fire on. Like not our von Neumann machine, like your instruction 1, data 1, instruction 2, data 2, bring one instruction, bring one data, compute. It is not. It is think of as a graph. The data is available at node, then when the data is available, it will just flow. And the another node is coming, like it's a data flow. Like whatever we are probably learned for the, our brain is working on that model. It is not that we have instruction by instruction, maybe multiple neurons are firing at a time, and they are taking, they're slower than your CPU. Clock speed, but they take decision much faster. So that is the still reason a robot cannot outperform a human being in take the 10 tasks. Maybe one single task robot is good, maybe chess player, but if you take the combination of human life, any fullest human being can outperform any robot. That's it. Yeah. So that is C profile. Eagerly means it will quickly do the correct thing. So eagerly is true. In TensorFlow 2, it is not there. Okay, one, it is not there. So it is a TensorFlow 2, it is true. Yeah, I think you understood. I think that will another way of this thing putting TensorFlow. Say you want to impress that I want the TensorFlow 2 itself, then you should put in try an accept block and you put it here ampersand this. And if it is not there, it will flow through an error. Okay. And so exception, so it is not exception, so it is TensorFlow 2 is there, so it will that this version is coming. I think am I understandable to you? If it is right now Colab gives TensorFlow version 2, but earlier it was giving TensorFlow 1, and you have to load TensorFlow 2 and run on it. Now the default is TensorFlow 2, but you somehow write a program which requires TensorFlow 2. You must do this thing, try accept block in Python, and you put this command, then only the TensorFlow 2 will log on. If it is not there, it will give error. Okay, that's it. Okay, I think then this is coming here. This is a tensor. This is a tensor. I am initialized and not only initialized 2, and I am making a matrix multiplication with tensor. Okay, this is a matrix multiplication. With a tensor, it will take 7 milliseconds. Let's, I think data will be not be much. We can try with only CPU mode, but that kind of data is available. So this is a tensor. Okay, this is a tensor. No, not this is a tensor. Sorry, this is not a tensor. This is a typical NumPy, and I am using the MAT2. This is a tensor because I am using TF dot. I am extremely sorry. This is a tensor because I am using this TF function. So I repeat once again. X is a variable. Okay. Now I am using M TF dot MATFLOW. TF means TensorFlow, not MAT. This is not NumPy. Okay. This is not NP. Okay. So this will run in a tensor. And which tensor? I have a GPU with the Colab. It is running there, and it takes 7 milliseconds there. Okay. I think more elaborate example we can. This is a NumPy. This one example I have given it. This is a from NumPy array, and this is a T dot shape. So if you see it, this is a kind of a tensor. This is a tensor with NumPy. Yeah, this is a tensor with a NumPy. The shape. Okay, this is a example of a tensor with a NumPy, and this is example of tensor, and I am MATMUL with the TensorFlow dot operation. Let's do some more example. Anything you have not understood, please tell me. Or any clarity? What I want to impress? Yes.
Understood, sir.
Yes, yes. It is okay. Okay, are you getting? What I am telling that because this whenever you go to this. You have learned well the NumPy, then whenever you just quickly switch to the TensorFlow 2, not go to TensorFlow 1 or Torch, it will be your programming will be what I can say it's much simpler. So though it is names are very heavy, but it is basically you are programming it by layer, because you know all the various intelligence techniques are all built in. You have to just put this. Then you might say, what is the point in it? Then what the computer scientists do? Yes, computer scientists can select the different selection. See now the vaccine. See the how the vaccine has come up. 7 or 8 vaccine or 10 vaccine are come up. This is purely because of machine learning. Because lots of not only doctors, lot of machine learnings are working on background that quickly come out. Lot of say right now another strain of virus is coming. Now, right now, the COVID-19 situation, you can incorporate this is machine learning, whatever you quickly learn with Python, with machine learning, with either a TensorFlow 2 or Torch or both. There are another software, it is called Keras. That is also a famous programmer is there. He developed the layers that you can incorporate the already various models are available at Torch that is Facebook and TensorFlow 2. So, and there are no such lots of like your GCD calculation, the algorithm or if then else or your what can I say in data structure, one of the very good programming tasks is quicksort, because quicksort the pointers are moving. Have you started it quicksort? The quicksort to the complexity of writing the programming, it's much simpler this machine learning model, because you are basically importing machine learning and you are using the layers and you are hyper tune these parameters, you are setting it, you are running it. And but what is the point in it? That you have to select various models are there, so you have to select at your application domain which model to use and which model not to use. That is the crucial. And hyper tuning the parameters and testing the data with test data, then your software output can match with the Facebook and all this. And if you can match them, they can take you. There is a leaderboard. There's some various open problems are there. Even the data set is there. If your problem running is coming next to them, your name will be available. That is called leaderboard. If you participate in Kaggle, they are also Python machine learning jobs. Their competition is there. So here there's another interesting. This is this here. Yeah, it is. There is a okay. So Any question till now, then you can tell me. Here, yeah, great. So here, this one I have shown, this one I used to show import sys. This one I like this command. I wish you also do it in your collab, because that will give a feeling. OS means which OS, and sys means which Python version. So this is the current Python version at collab. It is working, and what is the C library, it is working, and I am given the utility, and this is I am using one NumPy. I am using NumPy, yes. Yeah, this is a NP version, this problem, this particular one solution, y is equal to a bx cx square dx cube. And predict this is thing, and I want to calculate the values, and it takes 805 millisecond. If we do the torch instead of NumPy, let's see. It will take 403 millisecond. What I have to say, whenever using NumPy, it will take double the time. Whenever you take the torch, the same program with the torch with GPU-1 or TPU-1, it takes half. That is I want to impress upon you. I will show it. The program will be given to you. This is import torch, import math. This is I am getting the torch variable. All a torch means you can run it on a GPU. And after this program is a numerical, this numerical analysis program. This is the solution, this is a program, these are the gradient and all this learning and all. These are the output, it will take 403 milliseconds, and whenever it is learning with NumPy, the same code, this source code I have already given, and so it is taking 805 milliseconds, at least 50% half. Without whenever you take from instead of NumPy, go for torch, and the command is nothing but same import torch. You have to just say x is equal to instead of NumPy np dot line space, you have to say x is equal to torch dot line space, y is equal to torch dot sin x instead of np dot sin x. That's it, and all the variables a b c d are torch, so that it can be on GPU. Any question? So basically all NumPy commands 99.5% similar with torch and this thing, but it will give you at least 50% advantage for this, because you are using GPU. For if it is a video data, it will be 10 times faster, and audio data 10 times faster, that I can guarantee you. Now I will go back. So right now I am just today I am just finishing my talk. Whatever we have today discussed, today we have discussed the advantage of machine learning, because lots of label data that is there, and through label data we can teach our, we can write a program with the label data, we can write a program, that is our output. So machine learning is the output is a program, and that program is not stopped, it is self improving itself. That is the beauty of machine learning. Two kinds of machine learning is there. Next slide. Then another is the problem is overfitting. You should be aware of whenever you are predict a data that it is not too much fit. Because too much fit with the training data is okay, but whenever untested data is there, it fails, most probably fails. So it will be our overfitting should be avoided. Okay, so good generation is there. This is overfit. Overfit means as if you you join the datas. Like too many curvatures. Okay, that is it. We are mainly focused on supervised learning. This is it, and supervised learning mainly classification is a major problem. Regression is a continuous. Classification is the area where lots of work was there, and unsupervised another interesting area is clustering, where the classification without supervision is basically clustering, and this area reinforcement learning also. So with this, I think good enough. Now I should take one or two questions.